thank you for having me here. I want to warn you up front, this talk is going to be quite intense. So I'm going to speak pretty fast, I'm going to cover a lot of ground, I'm going to be very technical, and I'm not going to talk about functional programming at all. But there is some general plan here, you know, so I want to give you some high-level points, and I'm going to disclose this at the end of the talk, so you know, please bear with me, and it should be fun and interesting for you. And I want to start with a personal confession, and a shocking confession that I'm a very happy user and satisfied customer of Elixir. You know, the language is great, it's fun, it's approachable, it's simple, it's expressive, and we have a great ecosystem around Elixir, like a bunch of great libraries and frameworks, a lot of great stuff in there. But for me, by far, the most important thing about Elixir is the fact that our code runs on top of the Erlang virtual machine. And in particular, I'm referring to the official one, which is called Beam. You know, there are some other implementations out there of the Erlang VM, and I'm not going to discuss those today. But Beam is the thing that takes a bunch of these different languages and libraries and frameworks and whatnot and puts all of these things in a very distant and a very special place and make all of them very, very different and unique compared to anything else available out there. And as a primarily backend developer myself, I feel that Beam is the place where I get some tremendous help with some of the core challenges and essential challenges and difficult challenges that I'm supposed to face regardless of the particular nature of the project I'm working on. And that's what I'm going to argue today. I'm going to try to explain why exactly do I feel this way. And I want to start by saying that Beam, as the runtime layer, is really not good for every piece of software out there, which is precisely what makes it great, in my personal opinion. Because rather than trying to be a jack of all trades and therefore a master of none, Beam is built with a strong focus and a strong opinion on the kind of software that it's supposed to power. And I call such software a software system. And this is the kind of software that you build, deploy to production, start once, and from the moment on, it has to run constantly, continuously for a long time, like many years, maybe even decades in some cases. You really don't want to experience some blackouts and total downtimes, and as long as the system is running at any point in time, it has to do a bunch of different things, perform different tasks, to serve the needs of many users depending on the system 24/7. So think web backends, web servers of any kind, crawlers, chatbots. In the embedded area, we see a lot of interesting emerging examples. So you know, quite a lot of different software falls into this category of software systems. And then there's a lot of software which is not a software system, like one-off programs, which you start, you feed some input, it's chosen that input, and spits out some output an infinite amount of time. And if you're building those other kinds of things, especially on some larger scale, very likely Beam is not the hammer of your particular name. But if you are building a software system, any kind of a web-facing system, regardless of the business domain complexity or scale, there is no doubt in my mind that Beam-facing languages are currently your best bet, precisely because the runtime layer itself is built for that particular challenge. And this means that it has some properties and makes some strong guarantees, and in its implementation, some trade-offs have been taken, which are suited for software systems at the expense of any other type of software out there. And what I'm going to do today is I'm going to share with you some of these examples of properties and guarantees, and I'm going to try to explain why exactly do I feel they are very relevant in software systems. But first, I want to make sure that we're all on the same page, so just a little bit about how the runtime works. So like you build your system in Elixir, for example, and you start it somehow, and what happens is a single operating system process is started, and this is your own instance of Beam, and your entire system is running in that single operating system process. And then you have some threads in there, in particular the scheduler threads. There are some other as well, which I'm not going to discuss today. And by default, you have like one scheduler per CPU core. You can tweak this number, maybe higher or lower if you want to. And then you have a bunch of these little yellow boxes. And these are Elixir processes, or Erlang processes, or Beam processes. We just call them processes. And these are the things that you create. These are like small, lightweight, concurrent, separate programs that are running around your system. And you usually have a bunch of them running. Like, the way I like to describe it is the approach to idiomatic Elixir is you want to run different things separately. You want to have different activities of your system be powered by separate processes. Like each HTTP request handled in its own process, each database connection managed by its own process, each background job, periodic job, some piece of server-wide state you're managing, everything resides or is powered by its own process. And once you get accustomed to this idea, which is, you know, I can tell you from my experience, it's not really that hard, you're going to find out that there's a huge amount or huge potential for concurrency, even in simpler systems. Like in my experience, in smaller systems, you could easily have a few hundreds or maybe a few thousands of these things running around. And in larger systems, like hundreds of thousands, millions of processes might be present during some peak periods. And when done properly, this gives you a bunch of great benefits, like multi-core capability, vertical scalability, fault tolerance. It opens the door for being truly distributed across multiple machines, know, a lot of great stuff, a lot of superpowers we get by being concurrent and being. Now, what of course happens is you have these scheduler threads, and they are the one actually doing the work, right? And this is the first thing I'm going to talk about, in particular context switching in scheduler. So what happens is, like in naive version, a scheduler somehow picks a yellow box, picks a process, the process lands in the scheduler, and now it has some CPU time for itself, it can run some instructions. And while it has this time, it doesn't need CPU anymore. For example, it decides to sleep, or it awaits for an IO operation to finish, then it's going to be moved out and someone else gets the slot. But if the process is highly CPU bound for a long time, like maybe computing pi to billions of decimals, it's going to be switched out, it's going to be preempted. And this is usually going to happen pretty quickly from the moment it enters the scheduler. Like, no matter what the process does, about 1 millisecond after it hit the scheduler, it's out. I said usually because the actual implementation is not based on fixed time slices and interrupts. So, like, there are some possible, not very frequent, but still possible situations where a single process might linger around for some longer time. But I'm not aware of any kind of Elixir code we can write that will grab a scheduler and hold on to it forever. And therefore, for all intents and purposes, I tend to think of scheduler as being fully preempted. And we have full preemption and this frequent context switching. And what this means for our systems is a property which I like to call responsiveness. And rather than trying to be all theoretical and fuzzy about it, I'm going to try to show it through a simple demo. So I have a simple side loop here, and I'm going to start it now. I'm explicitly stating that I want to have just one scheduler thread, because this is going to make things a little bit easier to reason about. And I'm going to start a tool called Observer, which helps me visualize some stuff from my runtime, from my virtual machine. I'm going to add that to this load char stuff. And in particular, you can see here the scheduler one, so it proves that we have just one scheduler thread. You see this red line, so this indicates the scheduler utilization. It's already a little bit busy because this observer thingy is implemented in Erlang itself. Therefore, whatever it does, it needs this scheduler. And no matter how many processes I have, ultimately it boils down to a single thread. So this is like a single thread runtime. And now let me show you the site. So like I go here, I have an edit box, I give it a number, it gives me a larger number, it gives me sum of first n natural number. And like if I try with larger, I can get a larger sum. I'm really not sure whether this is at all correct because I have zero tests for that. But it doesn't matter for this particular demo. What matters is that the implementation is CPU bound completely. So like if I give it a large enough number, then it's gonna, you know, chew on it for a little while longer. So let me show you this. I'm gonna try with the magical number of 9 nines. So it's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. And as soon as I start this, you can tell on the right side, like the red line goes off and we are completely maxing out on our scheduler. And this is gonna now run for a little while longer. And there's no particular magic in the implementation. It's like pure simple sequential program goes from 1 to n, calculating the sum along the way. And yeah, we are now done. So I didn't use any trickery like yielding, sleeping, and whatnot. So let's try this again. This time I'm going to do something a little bit different. So I'm going to start this 9 nines again, 7, 8, 9. And I'm going to open up another tab. So this thing is running on my thread, but you know, like if I give it some other inputs, the system is giving me answers. It's responding to me, it's responsive. Now, meanwhile, this thing is still spinning, and now it's also done. And this is responsiveness. You know, just because I have to be super demanding and needy and greedy doesn't mean that all of you should be on hold. It provides service to everyone. So let's talk a little bit more about this. So let's say that you have like a server in production. Imagine that it is a single threaded and we have like 5 tasks pending, like 5 requests that need to be handled. All of them CPU bound. So like the first one, quite heavy, you know, 10 seconds of CPU time, but as you can see, it can happen under some conditions. And then like 4 brief runs, very brief runs, 1 millisecond each. So with beam type of scheduling, what you get is like after 5 milliseconds, you will have served 4 out of 5 requests. Then we're resuming the long run of computation, and even while we're doing this, we can still take more work and serve that work pretty quickly, assuming that work itself doesn't of course require a lot of CPU resources. So this is cool. This is what we want in a software system. Now in contrast with cooperative scheduling, and I want to stress here that like most of the other technologies, including some so-called Erlang alternatives we'll give you, with cooperative scheduling, the story goes different. Like when a task gets a computational resource, it doesn't let go for as long as it needs it. And hence, for the first 9,999 milliseconds, no one gets that response. Latencies for response times for everyone are 10 seconds plus, just because we have one very demanding user. And for a software system, in my opinion, this is like a pretty bad option. You know, I'm not suggesting that cooperative is universally bad, it actually makes more sense in some different scenarios, but for a software system where we're handling a bunch of different, mostly independent users, this is not a good option. And this problem persists even if you have multiple threads. You know, because the story is like the same regardless of the technology you're using. Like in a system in production, if it's moderately loaded, you're going to have a bunch of stuff, a bunch of activities that you need to do. And you're not going to have one thread per activity because operating system threads are quite expensive. So you usually have like a small and usually a fixed size pool of threads which are somehow juggling or multiplexing between those things. And now all that needs to happen with cooperative scheduling that a small fraction of your system is highly CPU greedy for a longer period and most of your system is on hold. Busyness of one or few leads to the paralysis of many or all. And this is not a theoretical issue, but like I've seen this thing happen in production. I've seen it take the complete production down. I mean, technically speaking, it was working, but response times were beyond anything acceptable. So from the standpoint of end users, it was done. Not only have I seen it happen, I actually made it happen myself. By mistake, of course, not intentionally, but you know, I make mistakes from time to time, like probably on a daily basis. And in this particular case, I wrote some shitty suboptimal piece of code. But this is an interesting example of how seeing the low-level technical property amplifies my mistake to some very, very bad consequences. Whereas Beam is, and not by chance, but by design, is way more forgiving towards such types of mistakes. Because like, if you have a couple of these long-running CPU bound tests, you know, it's not a problem. Like in the grand scheme of things, most people get your service pretty quickly. Now, obviously, of course, if the number of these things increases, then your performance degrades. But this degradation, like degradation of response times, is going to happen gradually, gracefully, and this will give you some window of time to spot that something is off and maybe fix your problem before it really takes your whole production down. And this leads me to the second point I want to discuss, and that's the fact that in Beam, your activities are first-class runtime things. Now, there are two sides to this story. So the first thing is, I mentioned already, you want to have different activities powered by separate processes. And process is a runtime thing in Beam, and therefore your activity is a runtime thing. And I'm stressing this because you have some other lightweight concurrency implementations out there, like most notably APCA, for example, where lightweight concurrency is provided at the library level, and then it simply follows that runtime has no clue about those things even existing. So that's not the case in Beam. Another side of the story is the fact that these processes have IDs, PIDs, we call them. Therefore, your activities actually have identities at the runtime level, which is again not always the case. The most notable example of this would be Go, which is based on the CSP concurrency model, and in CSP, your activities are anonymous and your communication channels have identities. Now, in Beam, our activities are runtime entities with identities. And what this means for us is that we can manage and manipulate our activities by talking to our runtime directly, even if the activities themselves refuse to work with us. And this is pretty important, but I understand it sounds completely fluffy and vague, so I'm going to try to demonstrate this again. So, I'm going to go to this site, and I'm going to show you a bug. You'll need to know what the problem is, but you know, like, let's pretend that we don't know, and we're going to see where it is. So, like, if I give it a negative number, then this thing like spins forever. You can see here the spinning wheel. Going to the observer thingy, you can see that we are maxing out our scheduler. And this thing never returns, you know, like, even if I close the tab, going here, it still spins. And it's going to spin forever, right? So as I've said, the site is responsive. So this is cool, right? So people get their service, this is pretty nice. But this thing is running, and if we have more of these things appearing, then ultimately we're going to get to some sort of a denial of service. So obviously we need to fix that. And assuming that I have like some proper monitoring and alerting system in place, I should get some mail like, hey, Sasha, your CPU usage is way off. You know, you may want to take a look at what goes on with your system. And this is what I'm going to do. Right? We're going to try to troubleshoot and find out where the problem is. And I'm going to do this in this IDX session in this console, but I want to stress that whatever I'm doing, you can do on production. You can hook into a running production without needing to restart it, without needing to set some trace flag, or God forbid, reconfigure and redeploy your entire system. So you can hook into running production and get a lot of info about your system by talking to your runtime about your activities. And this is the point which I'm trying to drive with this demo. So the question is, who is burning our CPU? Right? It has to be one or more processes. And therefore, the first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to ask my runtime about my processes or my activities, and I get a list of their identities, and now I can go through each PID, and I can ask my runtime something about each process. So in particular, I'm interested in a property which is called reductions or reduction count, which is, I'm going to keep it very simple and stupid. It is a number, the higher the number, the busier the process is. So like I'm simplifying it here, but that's good enough for this demo. So now I have that info, and now what I can do here is I can pack this thing in a tuple, it's like ABC, like Dora Me, you know, basically I have to sort this thing in a descending order. And let's take, say, top 5 of them. And let's print each one on a separate line. And there we have top 5 CPU spenders. And you can immediately tell that like the winner is way busier than the runner-up, and therefore this process here has got to be caused by our problems. So we were able to find it, and now I'm going to take it into a variable. Now I have it in a bit, and now I can do something else. I can ask my runtime something about that particular thing, for example, current stack trace. And I get some stack trace, you know, like this resolution is really not my friend. But what happens here is, like, at the bottom of the stack trace is something called Cowboy, which is an HTTP server library, so I already know that this is an HTTP request. And this is the router, so now I have narrowed the scope. Going a little bit to the top of the stack, I can see the action which I'm handling, and I can see my file and my line number. And now I have, like, quite a lot of info, so I can go back to the code, stare at it, you know, contemplate, and maybe some idea pops up, you know. But why start there when we can do much better when we can talk with our runtime about our activities? You know, I'm going to trace this thing. You know, I think about thousands or millions of things running around your system. You can point to that one and you can say, I want to see the dynamics of that thing without disturbing anything else which is actually serving your production. So I'm going to trace the activity of this process. I'm going to use a tool called DDG, which is, you know, don't be intimidated, it's a little bit gnarly and arcane, but it does the job, it's available out of the box. So, you know, like there are higher level things which you can use which are like more friendlier UX. So I'm going to start a DDG tracer. And I'm specify which process I want to trace. So it's this particular thing. And I'm interested in tracing function locations. Like you can trace a bunch of other stuff, such as messages being passed around, garbage collection, scheduling events, and whatnot. But I'm just interested in like what functions are being invoked there. And then I need to specify the so-called trace pattern. Basically, I'm stating that I want to trace every single function from every single module. And this is just going to generate a huge amount of output here. I'm going to basically get a denial of service in my shell, so I'm going to do like a very cheap trick, but it does the job. I'm going to sleep for a single second, and then I'm going to stop the DBG thing, and hopefully it's right. I'll check. Yeah, looks good from my end. Let's see. And stop. Perfect. So like I have 1 second trace of the activity in this particular process. But like the output is sort of shitty because of this low resolution, but what I can tell is that I'm recursing in this sum function. I'm infinitely recursing. And now, as a developer, I know where the problem is. You know, like I implemented this sum as a tail recursion. So I'm going from 1 to n, I'm passing 3 pieces of information. Start, the finish, and the currently accumulated sum. And I'm going to start when start and the finish are equal. Which is obviously not going to happen for any negative number or a floating point number. So it's a bug, right? It happens from time to time. And now I know where the problem is and I can go back to the code, fix it, even hot patch it without needing to restart the system. So that's all well and cool. But, you know, this production thing is still compromised, right? So like you still have this red line going on top there, so we're still maxing out on our scheduler. And I can do a little bit to help this production. So I can terminate this activity. Like I can send the so-called exit signal. And in particular, like an exit signal is an arbitrary term, but in particular I'm going to use the special one which is called kill, which is brutal termination or forceful termination. It's like kill minus 9 directly in bin. Right? So I can brutally terminate this thing, there is the error log, and you can tell here on the scheduler that our utilization now goes back to normal, and we can fix our production. Now, what has just happened? Like, to summarize, I have approached the running system, which had some flaw, and I was able to quickly sift through a bunch of things happening in there to find the problematic piece, drill into the rotten piece to see the root cause, and then take it out without disturbing anything else in my production. And this kind of level of service makes me an extremely happy user, makes me very confident about being able to manage my system, and I am unaware of anything else that comes even remotely close to such level of service. Like, even this seemingly simple and naive feature, which you would expect to have, like the ability to forcefully terminate an activity gone rogue, is going to be mission impossible for the vast majority of other technologies out there. Like, the best case that you're going to get is something along the lines of this. You can politely ask the thing to stop itself and then hope and pray that it's going to happen, which for this scenario is not going to be the case. And then your only best and only option is to terminate the entire operating system process, taking down thousands or millions of perfectly fine working healthy activities as a collateral. And in my opinion, this is predetermined. Now, being on top of being, we can do better than this. Like, I can ask the thing to politely stop itself, thus giving it some chance to flush its current work. But I can do better by working with my runtime. So I can ask my runtime, like, let me know if this thing terminates. Then I ask the thing politely to terminate, and then I'm waiting for a so-called down message, which I'm going to get if the thing infects or when the thing terminates. And I'm going to get it like no matter why it terminates. Like, maybe it stopped because I asked it to, or maybe it crashed before my message got there, and I'm going to know about it. So this is like one big and strong guarantee. Another thing is that I'm a separate process. I have my own flow, so I can like say, after 5 seconds, if I didn't get this message, then the thing refuses to stop, process exit with a reason killed, this is forced termination, and I'm done. And this is like a sketch of a please terminate or die brutally pattern, which you don't have to implement yourself. It's part of various instructions, most notably the supervisor from the OTP, but it's possible because you can work with your runtime. Another thing that is very easy and you have like a bunch of strong guarantees is cancellation. So like this sketch, this piece of code sketches the idea of a computation with a cutoff time, with a number of time limit. So I need to do some job, like doesn't matter whether it's IOS or CPU bound, I start the process, this is the task, task is just a wrap around process, so I start the job in there, then I go to task kill, which is going to return, which is going to wait for the result for at most 5 seconds. If I get the result, yay, I can do something about it. Otherwise, 5 seconds have passed, shut down with a reason brutal kill, under the hood, it does what it's shown you on the previous slide. And now, as the reader, when I'm reading this code, there are some strong facts of life here. Like, this piece of code is going to end eventually, usually in like at most 5 seconds plus a little bit of overhead. And once it's done, in the immediate next expression, I'm 100% sure that this task is not running anymore. This is a given thing, and hence when I'm reasoning about my system and my code, I can completely remove some possible hypotheses off the table and it simplifies my life in any way. And all of this is possible, starting from the previous demo all the way to here, primarily because I can work with my runtime and manage my activities by talking to my runtime director. Next thing I'm going to talk about, shared runtime concurrency. So this is like a fairly famous property of Erlang and Elixir or Beam. And I like to describe it like you have these little yellow boxes and they are literally separate programs. But they have nothing in common. Like they have their own execution flow, they have their own stack, their own heap. In some conditions they may even be running different versions of the same module, the same code. So really like separate programs that just happen to be running the same operating system process. Now, this separation is a great example of a kind of trade-off being done in Beam. Because if you have this total share nothingness, this means that when these things communicate, you're going to have to pay some price. Because usually like the messages being passed are deeply copied. There are some optimization exceptions, but for the most part, messages are deeply copied, and this requires some time. This is a performance penalty. Now, the cool thing is that this price is visible up front. You pay it immediately, you are aware of it, and by paying this price up front, you avoid a surprising, completely unpredictable and sometimes very, very big price of stop-the-world garbage collection. So we don't have that thing in Beam. We don't have stop-the-world garbage collection. And hence, when you're building your system, you're tuning it to get some target numbers, like you optimize it, you get reach your target numbers, put it into production, and you can sleep better. You can expect more stable latency distribution, less spikes, less surprises and gotchas there. Now, another thing about shared nothing is the fact that everything revolves, everything is owned by a process. Like, of course, memory I allocate is owned by a process, but also various resources such as file handles or network sockets or these things you have seen like traces and monitors. Everything is owned. Like, I open a socket and I'm the owner. And I can give it away to you and then you're the owner, but the big point is that someone is always the owner. And this ensures proper cleanup and avoids possible dangling resources. So, like, when a process terminates, whatever it owns, it's released. Like, memory is reclaimed immediately, doesn't even put the pressure on the GC, and any extra stuff such as files and network sockets are closed, even if the process is brutally terminated. You know, think about it, like, if I'm brutally terminated, there's no last words for me. I cannot do, like, try catch after final or something of the sort. Nonetheless, whatever I own is properly reclaimed. And I'm going to quickly showcase this as well in this demo. So, like, I'm going to do the Mac minus one thingy again, this time from the shell. And again, it's not returning. If we go to the observer, we are again maxing out. And now I'm going to head on to this processes stats, which is kind of like a top view of the activities of our system. And here I have this offender, which is processing stuff on the server side. And this is the owner of the socket on the server side. Right, and I'm going to terminate it brutally. Once I'm able to get the right click, OK, kill process. And going here, I get an empty reply from the server, thus proving that the socket has indeed been properly closed, although the process was brutally enforced to terminate. And finally, what I want to talk about is how OTP builds on top of these simple guarantees. You know, OTP is implemented in plain Erlang, and you could, in theory, re-implement it in some other, on top of some other platforms, but you need these guarantees, otherwise you don't get the proper OTP service. So in particular, I'm going to talk about supervision trees. Michal talked a little bit about that yesterday, and I'm going to rehash it in a slightly different way. So like the supervision tree, you have this OTP supervisor. And the idea is that you take this unorganized heap of those yellow boxes and organize them into a hierarchy of services, of subservices, of nanoservices, of microservices, of picoservices, and so on and so forth. Now this is basically your service manager, your system D, your upstart, if you will, except it's like a top-down view. So like this tree that you see here, this is an example of a thing, of a supervision tree which I used a year ago when I was demoing Phoenix. So like I have a top-level supervisor, I call it system, and system consists of two services, the backend and the frontend. And when I start the system, then we first start backend recursively, then we start frontend recursively. So that's the general idea. It ensures the proper starting order. And now my system is running, I have all my subservices running. And then in some cases, I want to stop some parts of my system. Like this is a legal scenario I've seen it happen from time to time, either by like a it's a request for business logic, or in some cases, due to fault tolerance, the supervisor might decide to try to stop some parts of the system in the attempt to self-heal the problematic case. And like, let's say that you want to stop the front-end thing, and this is what you expect to get, and this is what, in fact, you will get. But you will not get it by accident or by some stroke of luck. You will get it because the supervisor, which is implemented in plain Erlang, sits on top of these basic guarantees and properties. So in particular, frequent context switching with preemption means that like, even if the rest of your system is gone completely crazy and everyone else is looping in a CPU bound loop and doing nothing, the supervisor gets its time to do its job. Being able to work with its runtime means the supervisor can know whether some processes have stopped, and if they refuse to stop, it can ask the runtime to terminate them forcefully. And finally, shared nothing concurrency, in particular, the idea of process-based ownership means that whatever we stop, associated resources are properly reclaimed and we left no damning stuff behind. Now, if you take this supervisor and put it on a different kind of a runtime, and like imagine that you don't have all of these properties, pick either one and take them away. At the surface level, things might still look quite okay and work properly, but there will be some completely unobvious but very treacherous and dangerous problem lurking around. You might end up with unstoppable processes, and this might lead to race conditions and re-entry, and excessive CPU consumption, and excessive memory consumption. In some cases, the attempt of the system to self-heal is going to further aggravate the problem and lead to self-denial service. And essentially, your fault tolerance layer becomes itself faulty, and this is, in my opinion, pretty terrible because fault tolerance is like the essential property of any kind of software system. And this leads me to like the main point which I'm trying to drive here. So like this is my impression that as a community of software developers, when we're comparing different tools for jobs, we tend to put a lot of emphasis on these things here. And like sometimes watching all those friendly, nice, considerate, open-minded people on sites such as Reddit or Hacker News, I get this feeling that like a success and reliability of a complex software system depends on whether the underlying language has curly braces as block delimiters and semicolons, and whether you can build a log engine in 5 minutes. And like, I don't want to say that these things don't matter. Like, of course, we want to have some reasonable and uniform and regular syntax, and we want our syntax to be expressive, and we want to have rich ecosystems so we can actually focus on our core challenges, and we definitely want all these things to be approachable so new people can get on board. Right? So these things matter, but if they are built on top of an inappropriate runtime, which is not attuned for the kind of system that you're building yourself, then these are essentially a hollow shell, a shiny facade, hiding a very shaky, inappropriate structure. Now, in contrast, if your runtime is properly built for the kind of problem you're solving, then it's straightforward. Like, it takes a lot of time and effort, yes, but straightforward to support different syntaxes or even different paradigms, and to evolve your ecosystem and to flatten out the learning curve. And a great example of that theory practice is, of course, Elixir itself. And this is why I would say that when you're considering your tool for the job, especially if we're talking about the job of building a software system, maybe try to look past the language syntaxes and, you know, even paradigms and ecosystem, and maybe try to look at the runtime first and think about what kind of guarantees does it provide for you, because it can make a really, really huge difference. So some of the links, I can put some of the links for those who want to dive deeper into the Beam thingy, bit.ly/partialconf/beam, and there you're going to have a couple of links. And that's pretty much all that I prepared for you today, so thank you for your attention.